Good morning, everyone. I think we might get started since it's just after 12 now. My name is Jose De Silva, and I'm the curatorial assistant for film at the Queensland Art Gallery and Gallery of Modern Art. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you here today to this special In Conversation with APT5 artist Ding Kyu Lay and Mr. Tran Quoc Hay. As you will see in the video installation behind you, the three-channel video work by Din, it features Mr. Tran and the two helicopters that he engineered and fabricated over the past 7 to 10 years. What we're going to use this session for this morning is just to allow both Din and Mr. Tran to talk about their experiences, and perhaps Din will start by just giving you a little bit of information about the genesis of the work and how he discovered Mr. Tran, and then allow Mr. Tran to talk about his experience of the helicopter, both growing up in Vietnam. Mr. Tran grew up near a military airbase, and so from a very early age had the experience of seeing American helicopters, and then obviously living through the American Vietnam War and reinterpreting the meaning of the helicopter for contemporary Vietnamese. So Din, if you'd like to just start by perhaps giving the audience a little bit of information about how you came to make this work.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. About 2 years ago, a little bit more than 2 years ago, I read in a newspaper in Vietnam this kind of short human interest story about a farmer, Mr. Tran, who lives in a farming community near the border between Vietnam and Cambodia, and about he kind of handmade a helicopter, and supposedly they were testing it, and the government sort of confiscated it because they didn't get permission to fly this object, this helicopter. And I think the first thing I thought was, this is really interesting, because if you're familiar with Vietnam history and the Vietnam-American War, the helicopter was the first time used extensively in a war situation in Vietnam. And today, almost virtually any war that's taking place anywhere in the world require the use of helicopters. So Vietnam was the first testing ground for the helicopter as a war machine. And for the Vietnamese, the helicopter is a death machine. It's a machine that appear nowhere and start to kill people. That's for a lot of people in Vietnam. So when Mr. Tran helicopter appear and the press spoke to him why he wanted to build the helicopter, and there's he state that he want to use the helicopter to show the world that the Vietnamese can do anything that the world can, number one, and number two, that he want to create a cheaper version of helicopter for the government to use it for rescue operation to help people. And I thought it was a really kind of interesting changes in the thinking of Vietnam, because, you know, from a death machine, a machine that kill, to now to a whole different way of thinking about this machine, this helicopter, can become something to help people. But at the same time, also, it's also marked a changes in Vietnam economically also, because for after the war, the country is devastated economically, so we have to rebuild the country. And so for years, people are just trying to survive and really, you know, finding the next meals to put on the table and for their family. But then in the last decade or so, Vietnam economically is doing much better, and we're finally at a place where we're not too bad. And I think so that's as a result where there's we don't have to worry so much about survival now, and we have time and a little bit extra income left to follow our dreams. And I think Mr. Tran is a perfect example how he now can, you know, put aside some money to kind of build this helicopter, which is a dream of his since childhood. And so not only it's kind of marking a shift in the memory of the war, but also marking a kind of economic change in our country. But at the same time, after he tested the first helicopter, the government confiscated, and the press wrote about it, and there was an outpour of support from the country, from the lay people to scientists in the community to engineer. They all wrote in to say, you know, they will support him and give him all any kind of advice, expertise, and things like that to help him continue with his building the helicopter. And eventually the government relent and give him back the helicopter. And eventually, a couple of months later, also give him something like the Labor of the Year award. But what I find interesting is that the people who wrote in support, I think in a way, his dream awoke other people, awoke the Vietnamese, because we've been working so hard to rebuild the country that I think we forgot the dream. And when Mr. Trang and his dream, his helicopter, kind of was, you know, shown to the community, people remember what it's like to dream again. And I think that's why he got such a support from the community. And so as a result, he's a big kind of celebrity in Vietnam these days. And with all of that thinking, so I want to kind of make a work that's kind of work about the changes. So the work is an interweaving. It's a tapestry of memories from the past to the present, between one generation and another, between fiction and nonfiction, between documentary images and Hollywood fictions. And so this work is a combination of all this kind of memory, and hopefully lead you to either contemporary Vietnam or let you to think of a future Vietnam. But now I'm gonna let you hear the story from Mr. Trang about his love or his obsession with the helicopter and how it began.
Tôi là một người yêu khoa học, tôi thích chế tạo tất cả mọi cái, trong đó có chiếc trực thăng là cái tác phẩm đỉnh cao của tôi.
I love science and I love inventing things. Among my achievements, the helicopter is my highest achievement so far.
Ngày xưa gia đình tôi sống gần trong thời chiến tranh đó, ở phía sau gia đình nhà tôi là một cái căn cứ của quân đội đồng minh.
During the war years, behind our house, there was a camp of the aliens.
Tôi thường xem máy bay lên xuống để tiếp liệu cho các vùng chiến tranh khác.
I would watch the helicopters flying up and lifting up and down for fueling.
Tôi có thể xem máy bay trực thăng hàng giờ, và đó là cũng là một cái định mệnh gắn tôi suốt cuộc đời.
And I spent hours watching the helicopters, and that became the destiny of my life.
Cách đây 10 năm khi cái ý đủ lớn và kiến thức đủ rộng, và vào lúc đó chính phủ Việt Nam khuyến khích phát triển khoa học kỹ thuật trên mọi lĩnh vực.
10 years ago, when I've got enough knowledge and understanding, and at the same time, the government of Vietnam emphasized on the development of science and technology.
Tôi bắt đầu bắt tay vào chế tạo chiếc máy bay trực thăng đầu tiên.
I started inventing the new helicopter.
Và chúng tôi thử nghiệm bằng chủ yếu bằng khung sườn và máy.
But we did experiments mainly on frames and engines.
Cái trực thăng khó nhất là bốc lên và ổn định. Và chúng tôi đã đạt được cái yêu cầu đó ở độ cao 2 mét.
The most difficult things with helicopter is to lift off the ground and stay airborne, and we could overcome that challenge.
Bằng cách thử theo phương pháp Sikorsky, dùng phương pháp neo dây.
We adopted Turkovsky method.
Sau đó chúng tôi với thành công đó chúng tôi mới đem máy bay về hoàn chỉnh để thử những cái bước tiếp theo gồm có tới lùi, trái phải và đảo vòng.
With that achievement, we move on with the completion of the process, including moving forward, backward, moving around, and turn over.
Thì bị chính quyền Việt Nam bắt giữ.
At that time, the helicopter was confiscated by the government of Vietnam.
Với lý do là ảnh hưởng an ninh quốc phòng.
The government cited the reasons of national defense.
Chúng tôi có tranh luận, tức là chính phủ tại sao khuyến khích phát triển khoa học kỹ thuật trên mọi lĩnh vực, nhưng mà chúng tôi làm khoa học thì bị bắt giữ sản phẩm.
We disagree with that reason because once on the one hand the government encouraged the development of science technology, but on the other hand it confiscated our work.
Họ đổ thừa cho cơ chế, quý vị nên biết.
That they resorted, they cited the reasons of law, and you should be reminded that.
Là Việt Nam, ở Việt Nam tồn tại song song giữa luật pháp và cơ chế.
In Vietnam, there are two systems coexisting, that is law and mechanism.
Cơ chế là một cái lực bất thành văn nhưng nó quyết định tất cả mọi thứ.
Mechanism is something which is unwritten law, but that controls everything.
Sau đó qua báo chí thì được sự ủng hộ mạnh mẽ của nhân dân trong nước và các kiều bào nước ngoài và những người yêu thích khoa học.
Through the media, I receive immense support from people inside and outside the country and those who love science and technology.
Dưới áp lực như thế thì họ trả máy bay lại cho tôi và ký giấy là cấm máy bay hoạt động với mọi hình thức.
Under that pressure, the government released our helicopter, but on the condition that we could not do anything on it.
Nhưng với sự ủng hộ của nhân dân trong và ngoài nước và những người yêu khoa học, các đoàn trong ngoài nước thường đến thăm tôi.
But again, with the support from people inside and outside the country, and there's a lot of scientific delegation who paid visits to me.
Đó là động lực thúc đẩy cho tôi tiếp tục cái công việc bỏ dở.
That was a motivation for me to going on with my experiment.
Bởi vì thứ nhất khi bị bắt giữ thì những người hiếu kỳ họ đã giảm đạp hư và cái bộ khoa học công nghệ nói là không có cái gì mới hết.
When the helicopter was confiscated, lay people and both scientific researchers confirmed that there's nothing wrong with the technology. There's nothing serious.
Tôi quyết định chế chiếc thứ hai với những tính năng mới.
I decided to invent the second helicopter with new functions.
Cũng được sự ủng hộ của nhân dân trong và ngoài nước.
And again with the support from the people both inside Vietnam and outside.
Sau đó chính phủ có cử một đoàn khoa học cao cấp ở trung ương vào.
Then the government sent a scientific delegation from the central government to visit me.
Cho phép chúng tôi thử nghiệm hết sức khắc nghiệt và vô lý.
They allow us to go on with the experiments activities, but on a very unreasonable and strict conditions.
Tức là máy bay chỉ được bay lên khỏi mặt đất trong vòng 1 mét trở lại.
That means that the helicopter can only lift off the ground for within 1 meter.
Và chúng tôi phải tự bỏ tiền ra làm tất cả mọi thứ.
And we have to pay for every expenses.
Cụ thể là phải xây dựng một cái bức tường bề cao 5 mét, rộng nửa hecta trong vòng chu vi 50 hecta của đất chúng tôi.
Particularly, we have to build up the fence with 5 meters tall for half kilometers or square meter.
Chúng tôi thấy đó là một cái điều vô lý, nhưng mà thử nghiệm còn hơn bỏ máy bay đĩa sét.
we know that that is a very, very unreasonable condition, but we better go on with the experiment rather than leaving things undone.
Trong đó có việc phân biệt đối xử.
And of course that is discrimination.
Những người hiếu kỳ tới xem vào đất chúng tôi và khu vực chúng tôi thử và những cán bộ cử xuống giám sát.
The people who interested in our works and the people seconded to supervise our work.
Mà chúng tôi không yêu cầu.
Even without our invitation.
Nếu có gì thiệt hại đến mạng chúng tôi phải hoàn toàn chịu trách nhiệm.
If anything happening to them, we have to be solely responsible for it.
Nhưng riêng sinh mạng chúng tôi làm khoa học kỹ thuật theo lời khuyến khích của nhà nước thì ông hay nói tới.
But our lives, as the people who are doing scientific and research experiments to the core of the government, are not careful.
Với thời gian thử nghiệm là 3 tháng kể ngày bắt đầu làm việc.
The time limit for the experiment is 3 months from the commencement of the work.
Sau đó thì không được quyền tiếp tục nữa.
Then we must stop totally.
Nhưng đến bây giờ thời gian đã hết. 31/12 là hạn cuối cùng nhưng mà hiện giờ chúng tôi không nhận được một cái văn bản nào cả.
The 31st of December is the deadline, but so far we haven't received any approval confirmation, written approval.
Như vậy tương lai phát triển khoa học kỹ thuật của Việt Nam vô cùng khó khăn và chưa biết đi về đâu.
That means that in the future, development, scientific and technology development in Vietnam is very difficult, and we are not sure about its future.
Tôi cảm ơn tất cả những người dự ở trong khán phòng này.
I would like to send my warmest thanks to everybody in the audience.
Và Viện Bảo tàng Queensland đã tạo điều kiện cho tôi.
And the State of Queensland Gallery. Which provides support to me.
Được giao lưu với cộng đồng.
Allow me to interact with the audience and the public.
Và chính phủ Úc.
And the government of Australia.
Hết xin hết.
Thank you very much.
Are there any questions for either Ding Kule or Mr. Tran? We've got a little bit of time to take some questions if anyone would like to ask anything.
Oh, not loud enough. Mr. Tran? Yes? Mr. Tran, I'm curious to know if after the deadline, what are your plans once the deadline is over?
Cảm ơn. Tức là hạn cuối cùng của tôi là 31/12/2006.
Thank you very much for your questions. And the deadline is the 31st of December 2006.
Sau đó là không được quyền thử nghiệm nữa. Dù cho hay không cho mà tôi cũng chưa biết đó, khi tôi thử nghiệm thì cái máy bay tôi chúng tôi đi về đâu, nhưng mà cái máu nó chảy đã chảy ra quý quản thôi rồi, dứt khoát tôi sẽ làm tiếp.
The government doesn't allow us to do anything after that deadline, but because the desire, the passion to build the helicopters is embedded in me, inside me, so I will definitely do carry on the work even without knowing what will happen to me.
Din, I have a little question. I wondered if you might be able to speak a little bit about the ideas of memory that kind of work throughout the video work. I know that there is a sort of distinct blurring between what are documentary footage and what is sort of cinematic reinterpretations of the war. And I wondered if you could talk about your own experiences of memory of the event and how perhaps that informed the choice of content that you used in the video work and how you actually edited it together.
I think for my memory, it's
I think for everybody knows that our memory changes constantly. It's not as concrete as we want it to be. And I think it's also very different for generation to generation also. Particularly to the Vietnam War, my memory of the Vietnam War come from three different sources. Personal memory as a child growing up in Vietnam and experienced the Vietnam War. And then I moved to America. And then, you know, out of curiosity and the need to kind of understand this event that sort of that altered my life and kind of have a major impact on my life and my family. So then, you know, I started read about it, doing research about it, looking at documentary footage, documentary photo during the Vietnam War. So that's the second set of memory. And then the third set of memory come from Hollywood movies. So again, out of curiosity, what my friends in America were telling me about what they saw on the big screen, because personally, I never really want to go see a Vietnam War movie. But after a while, you have to see because everybody's talking about it. Yeah. So after watching, you know, movie like Apocalypse Now, Platoon, and all that, so that became a third set of memory about the Vietnam War. But they are merging into one another as times go by. So my memory today, it's emerging between facts and fictions. An example is that when I was in California a couple of years ago visiting my mother, who lives in Southern California, and we have a brush fire in the backyard, in the mountains surrounding the area. And I walked out the backyard of my mom's house, and smoke was everywhere. And it's have that orangey smoke that you've seen so much in Hollywood movies, that orange kind of reddish smoke. And helicopters was flying everywhere. They were trying to drop fire retardant on the fire. But the first thing that came to my mind was that, wow, this is like the Vietnam War. But then I also catch myself pretty fast after that, because I realized that my memory of the Vietnam War doesn't have helicopter. My actual memory of the Vietnam War doesn't have helicopter. That memory came from Hollywood. So in a way, it's like, and I think particularly for the younger generation today, they have no memory of the Vietnam War except watching Apocalypse Now or The Deer Hunter. So our memory of the Vietnam War today is very, the older generation, they remember what it's like sitting, watching the evening news about the Vietnam War. And then, of course, then the watching Hollywood movies. The younger generation today only have memory of Hollywood. And so when I make this movie, I want to kind of, because this work is about memory in a way. It's about all this memory that we're trying to get over, to try to move beyond. And so that memory is including everything between facts and fiction, between documentary, between personal story to Hollywood memory. And so that's how this work came about.
Mr. Drung, you had never seen a helicopter before. I just wonder how you interpreted it when you first saw a helicopter.
Khi tôi nhìn chiếc máy bay trực thăng đầu tiên, giờ lúc đó tôi học đang học tiểu học, tôi nghĩ rằng đó là một cái cỗ máy kỳ diệu mà chỉ có những người châu Âu mới làm được. Còn người da vàng là thượng đế không cho họ làm.
Wow, I first saw the helicopter when I was in primary school, and at that time I thought that the helicopter was a very magic machine which could only be made by the Westerners, and which the Asian people like us could not do it.
Sau đó khi Việt Nam quá chiến tranh thì người Mỹ mới chuyển dần những phi công Mỹ chuyển sang phi công Việt Nam.
When the American weathermen stitched the Vietnamizations of the war, and then they were caught, brought the helicopters into the country.
Thì người Việt Nam làm rất tốt.
And the Vietnamese could do it very well.
Thì tôi nghĩ rằng khi lái máy bay được, thì chịu học tập, học hỏi một thời gian và chịu nghiên cứu, tìm tòi. Thì người Việt Nam cũng chế được máy bay như người châu Âu.
And then I came to believe that if a person could fly an airplane or helicopter, and if that person could do research and study, he could manufacture a helicopter like the Westerners.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you everyone for coming. I know that Din and Mr. Trang will be in the space afterwards, so if you have any other questions that you would like to ask them, please, by all means, make yourself known. I'd also like to just remind you that Din is also part of a very strong presence of Vietnamese artists in APT5, including the senior filmmaker Viet Linh, who will start her series of screenings tonight in the Australian Cinematheque at 7 o'clock with her latest feature, Mi Tao. Please join me with thanking Din Kyu Le and Trang Quoc Hay.
Thank you.